All of us here, we wish you all a lot of fun playing games this year. So thank you very much and have a great E3.
I wanted to linger on this moment because I think it's pretty special. Today, during the Ubisoft E3 2013 press conference, we got to see, after an hour of incredible games being showed to the world, a team, collaborators that represent hundreds more developers and tens of thousands of developers across the industry, came on the stage to celebrate what they've done and the work they're building. It was something special because it was real, it was raw. It wasn't game changers and thought influencers trying to convince you to play their products. It was people that made something trying to convince you to hear their stories. What we saw today made me feel again that stirring, those tears that you feel when you know someone is giving it their all, is trying to show you part of their soul. Today, Ubisoft showed us again why we love video games, why we all do. It's not about the product. It's about what happens when a few hardworking individuals follow a vision and choose to express that idea to people like me and you. It resonates. It creates something beautiful and something special to us. I want to single out three individuals in the press conference that I think deserve to be recognized. First off is Ashram Ishmael. I'm really sorry if I say any of these names incorrectly. Game director on the new Assassin's Creed Origins game. While he was showcasing this game for the first time to the world, he took time to give credence and accolades to his team, the team that worked together, because games are a collaborative art form. And even though he could have used that to tell us about a cool new feature or a new segment, it was important to him that we understood that this was not an individual effort. The showcase ended with an actual trailer for Beyond Good and Evil 2. Blew me away, one of my favorite game franchises of all time. I was crying there, but we got to see from Michel Ancel, the creative director on Beyond Good and Evil 2, those moments when he came on stage to showcase a game that is 15 years in the making, tears welling up in his eyes because he knows how important this is to him and to people like him to hear his vision. Now, this last one, it got me something fierce. Early on, the big M, Miyamoto himself, was there to showcase their new game that they're working with Ubisoft, Mario and Rabbids, which looks really fun and exciting. And he took a moment to single out, and I'm sorry if I get the name incorrect, David Solani. This is a guy that's looked up to Miyamoto since he started. This is a guy that knows that Miyamoto has brought forth this renaissance that allows him to operate in this field. And he's getting accolades and love from essentially the forebearers of everything that means something to him. You see it in the video. This means the world to him. And I think it just speaks to the idea that these games are great. They're fun. They're forms of expression, but they're also people's souls. So I want to give a hand and just take a moment to thank the video game developers at Ubisoft for giving us an incredible showcase, and the thousands of video game developers around the world that continuously keep building things that are great, that have truth. Thank you so very much. It's easy to be cynical, and this showcase showed us we don't have to be. All right, I want to get to the games because there sure as hell are a lot of them. Let's start right from the beginning of this. Miyamoto welcomed on to the E3 stage at Ubisoft and told these poor Ubisoft developers to make a Mario game that is Western and isn't about jumping. We got to see Mario plus Rabbids, and that's exactly what it is. It's a funny, light, kind of Mario meets XCOM take at one of the most beloved and established franchises in the world. I cannot wait for it. I feel like it will introduce a whole new generation of gamers to Mario and what that means. And I didn't think you could do it. I didn't think that you could take Mario and reinvent him in this way. I think this could be what Mario Kart was way back when for the franchise. That's what Mario plus Rabbids could be. And I love the fact that Miyamoto isn't afraid to let his brand kind of stray away a little bit, to try something new and exciting. Big thumbs up, and it shows innovation. It's so much better than what we saw before. So already starts off with that, and then that goes very seamlessly into Assassin's Creed Origins. We didn't get to see a lot of gameplay from it. There was some after the conference, but one of the highlights was, of course, the dog death Anubis heads, and just a creative team that understands that this needs to be open world, maybe take some cues from CD Projekt Red and The Witcher. All looks good. I think if you've been waiting for an Assassin's Creed game, this should check off some of the boxes you need. And it seems to work better with the established lore. The idea that you are an assassin in the truest form, that your role is to kill for your death god, that's some Dark Brotherhood, bring me back to killing for good reasons, damn it. I'm excited about it. And then that went into, of course, the crew with some Lord music, Crew 2. Not what I'm looking for, but millions of people enjoyed the game. Clearly, this is speaking to some sort of audience. And that's when we went into essentially just bing, bang, boom moments, where we saw trailer after trailer after trailer. Fractured Butthole. Boom. We get to see Randy Marsh drinking some wine. Looks like the great gameplay we've seen before. I'm a little concerned just because they were so great. E3 Ubisoft Showcase was so great that might have been one of the games that showed the least amount of initiative, just because the first game broke so much ground. How do you make changes on a game that already established itself as a game changer? Ironically, I don't think that it will necessarily reach that point, but people are going to be playing it this week at E3. Kudos, love, everything you need from there. The next ones were kind of strange. We got to see an indie game with Frodo himself in it, this kind of VR take called Transference. Am I getting this right? Is that it? Yeah, there's no one here. So it kind of goes into the brand that Elijah Wood has been establishing with his Netflix shows, with his artistic direction that he's been taking. I see this as more of an interactive art piece, which, again, I'm down for. Maybe not a game, but I need some reason to use VR. And then right after that, Skull and Bones, a multiplayer pirate game. Maybe not your biggest highlight, but if you're a fan of everything that was great in Assassin's Creed 4, they worked really hard at building up that tech and haven't had a chance to use it. Why not give it to these people? It's not something I would enjoy, but when we look at the esports market and how it's developing and what they tried to do with For Honor, again, I like it because it shows that Ubisoft is working within the framework that they've been developing, sharing resources, and trying new things. You know, they're not just resting on their laurels with another Assassin's Creed. They made a great pirate game. Let's double the ante and do it again. Now, we also heard from a mobile South Park game. Doesn't really interest me, probably interests other people. It's a huge market that in the next 5 years, well, I think it's close to 70%, 75%, eclipse the total game sales for all other markets. So it's something that we should be referring to. That's, though, when we got to see a little love for Ubisoft Toronto. We live in Toronto here. We've been to Ubisoft Toronto many times. They're incredible hosts and really help us out. And they didn't tell us anything about this game. Starlight, I believe, if I'm saying that correctly. Yes, Starlight. We're going to go with that. Starlink. There we go. Very sorry, Matt Rose from Ubisoft Toronto. It uses IRL game pieces to kind of mash up an idea of, how would you describe it? No Man's Sky meets Skylanders sort of thing. I think it's pretty cool tech. I know how hard they work in Toronto, and I'm just surprised they were able to keep it under wraps for as long as they did. We got to see some Steep Road to the Olympics. Fun, fun, fun. I don't know about you, but I've had a lot of fun in my Hardscrabble youth playing those great, like, Beijing, what was it, 2002 Winter Sports Olympic Games. Those are really fun. If they can bring that back, as Steep was an incredible achievement, and kind of capture that essence a little bit, the early 2000s take on these time trials and just trying to get the golds. I'm due for another great Olympics game, and Ubisoft, again, they're using the tech they already have. They have the pirate ships, they make a pirate game. They mapped out a mountain where someone died. Let's use that mountain for something. Good, 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 exciting. And that's when we have, I want to think, probably our two biggest things. Dan Hay, the creative director on Far Cry and also kind of the brand director on all the games, who's spoken about the trajectory of Far Cry 5, was there to show us some of the game. It has the similar iconography that mirrors our time right now with Resist. It's a heady issue, and I really want to talk more about it because I think Ubisoft runs the risk of humanizing the alt-right a little bit, but they could also be creating an incredible human commentary on America in 2017 and over the past few years. Dan Hay has spoken to the fact that the country is changing. He's a brilliant, brilliant game developer and game creator, along with the team that's made Far Cry. From what I saw so far, they're using the Far Cry Primal tech of having the beasts in. They're using the Ghost Recon tech of having the bounce in players to come in with co-op. I hope that these games that live and die on their narrative weight can find an audience that believes the narrative arc is genuine. You know, if they do want to make a social commentary on what it is like in the Deep South, or in the Midwest, I should say, for many Americans, and how there is that sense of isolationism and the role of religion, incredibly heady topics that I want to be a part of and I'd like to play. I just don't want to see it coolified too much, where these evil characters are given some personifying qualities that make them seem redeemable when maybe the ideology isn't. Just, it's a mixed bag, but again, they're trying something new. It's a hard topic, it's heady, there might be some blowback, but they're doing something that's innovative. They're not adding a story mode to Madden. You know, they're not getting, you know, maybe we'll do a story in Battlefront 2. No, they're building something new and exciting, and I frankly cannot wait for it. And I got some notes here, but I don't need the notes for this one, because finally, we ended with Beyond Good and Evil 2. We got to see a trailer, and the creative director that went on stage and started to cry, I understand, because he's crying for people like me that grew up playing that game, listening to the themes of resistance and civil disobedience, and having strong feminists, that's right, feminist characters that are willing to push the narrative forward in interesting ways. Beyond Good and Evil 2, just for a second, seems to capture that same tone, that same atmosphere. And that was by far the most exciting thing I've seen so far in E3. Ubisoft has shown, and it was just a trailer, so we didn't get a lot, but I really think Ubisoft has shown that they see games now as something more. More than just products, more than even forms of entertainment, but expressions of truth. An individual's expression, a collaborative group trying to give us something. And the idea that they got to do this on a stage in front of millions of people, and they chose to honor the people that made the games instead of wasting time telling us all the fancy new features, makes me feel special. And I think that they have completely blown everyone else out of the water here. Ubisoft, E3, my winner. I clearly have some emotional attachment here. What about you guys? Do you think that they have really gotten past that mark and have done something special? Or am I a Ubisoft apologist that should be put out to pasture? We'll see. Andy Burkowski, BGS.